So next, you know, we'll go to some of these discussions about, you know, building real-time data pipeline and what are the challenges that you face and solutions and all that, right? So I know I am standing between you and your lunch. You know, I will try to make it as interesting as possible so that, you know, you forget your lunch. Okay, so let's see, you know, without wasting any minute, you know, I'll directly jump into the topics, right? Who am I? So my name is Veeramani Moorthy. I'm working here in Intuit as a data architect, right? So we have recently built a near real-time data pipeline, and we have deployed it in production and it's working fine. So that's why I'm here to discuss. So we have faced, you know, n number of challenges, right? Not one or two, and those challenges were like not something, you know, which I used to face it earlier in my job, and you know, I just have to copy the same solution here. You know, they were like totally new challenges, and what was interesting was, like, you know, the whole ecosystem is still evolving, and, you know, and these are the challenges, you know, which you know, anybody who builds a real-time pipe, you know, will face that, and, you know, that's why I'm here to share some of the challenges that we have faced and, you know, how did we deal with it, right? So if you want to connect with me, you know, my email ID is this. This is my office email ID, veeramani_moorthy@intuit.com, and Gmail is this. I'm available at LinkedIn as well, okay? So let's go. So what is the agenda? So first I will cover, you know, what is the business goal, and then we'll talk about the architecture, right? And then, you know, what are the challenges that we encountered and how did we deal with it, right? And I'll also talk about, you know, the metrics and monitoring architecture and some of the challenges that we faced here. And of course, you know, I'm not capturing all the challenges that we have faced, primarily for the benefit of time. If I want to talk about all of them, you know, probably I might need like 4-5 hours, right? So I have picked few challenges, you know, which are kind of, you know, more critical, and I'm going to discuss about that. And at the end, you know, you'll have Q&A, but anytime, you know, feel free to ask any questions, right? So next, so what is the business goal? So the business goal is this, very simple. Build a real-time, low-latency pipeline. In our case, you know, the SLA was 1 minute, right? Which can listen to the database state changes, right? And transform and publish it to the Salesforce, right? In our case, it's Salesforce, and it need not be Salesforce, and you can even publish it to any other destination, right? So this was the case. So when we say transform, you know, it implicitly means the streaming join as well. You know, we will see that, right? So the other thing was zero data loss, right? In general, you know, you would have seen a bunch of pipeline, you know, which is built for, you know, ad platform or, you know, clickstream thing, you know, where minimal data loss is, you know, acceptable. But the moment you get into the financial data where, or the customer data, you know, this is one of the major requirement in which comes. And the next one is ordering guarantee. You know, you cannot, even though if the orders are, you know, mismatched, then, you know, you have to know how to deal with it. So this is a good enough recipe for adding hell lot of complexity. Right? So this is the architecture, you know, we call it as a company, which is a code name, right? So what you see here is a database, source database, right? So this is where some web application is making state changes. Basically, you know, it's committing database transactions, right? As and when any transaction is occurring here, right, now we need to listen to that and capture them, and then, you know, transform and finally send it to the Salesforce.
Right, is it only for MySQL, or you have other n number of databases?
So here, you know, we have to do it for MSQL Server.
Okay.
But, you know, we already have a solution for Oracle database as well. So in case of Oracle database, you know, we are using Oracle Golden Gate adapter as a solution. So Golden Gate has a replication functionality, right? So we are using that to, you know, stream the data from source database and publish it to the outside. So basically, you know, depending on what source you have, only this ingestion technology is going to be changing. But rest of the pipe is going to be
same. This is the complex thing in itself, I guess.
Sorry?
I mean, having this change data stream for all the databases is a complex topic in itself.
Correct.
I mean, I think not every database, let's say Cassandra and all, not everyone provides this change data stream.
Yeah.
Okay.
We can
connect
Oracle
with? Yeah, so we can do that. In fact, you know, we have the solution. For Oracle, you know, we are using Golden Gate adapter, to do that. You can use Kafka Connect as well, but the problem is, in case of Oracle, you know, you use the Golden Gate for replication, right? And it has the trial files, right? So those trial files are, you know, being streamed using a Golden Gate adapter, and we are publishing it to the Kafka topic. So here in this case, in a MS SQL server, you know, the database itself has another schema called CDC schema. So that's where all the CDC information are stored. But in case of Oracle, you know, the trial files is the place where all the CDC information are stored. So basically, you know, depending on the source, you know, you might need to pick the right ingestion technology.
CDC is an Oracle or an MS SQL?
The CDC is a concept, right? You know, change data capture. That is the concept. But you know, it's available in both Oracle and MS SQL Server itself. But in case of MS SQL Server, you know, they are creating a separate database schema, and for each table that you want to CDC, you know, you will have a parallel table. So that will be available in this separate CDC schema. But in case of Oracle, you know, this thing is totally different. You know, they are using files, the normal files as a trial files, and that's where the CDCs are captured. And it is replayed in to replicate the database.
Sorry, this is MS SQL, not MySQL.
Yeah, this is MS SQL.
Okay.
So,
if Golden
Gate provides.
Yes.
So, Kafka Connect doesn't come with a default connection towards this MS SQL. So, you use the Golden Gate.
No, Kafka Connect comes up with the JDBC connector. But you know, that cannot directly talk to the CDC schema. So we have built a connector. So we are using a Kafka Connect framework, but you know, we have built a connector and which can go and query the CDC schema and pull the data from there. Right? So basically, you know, here we have deployed our connector and which is going and pulling the data from this source database every second. Right? And what it does is, you know, it, for each record, you know, it pulls, you know, it's basically a JDBC result set, right? And it creates a schema. So here in this case, you know, we are having an Avro schema, and that Avro schema is registered with the schema registry, which is coming from Confluent. You know, it's a Confluent technology, and then, you know, it creates an Avro record out of that result set, right? And it publishes the Avro record to the Kafka topic. So here we call it as a raw Kafka topic because, you know, no processing has happened yet, right? And so one other thing to note down here is, like, you know, are we using a multi-partitioned Kafka topic or single-partitioned Kafka topic? You know, in our case, you know, in many, you know, we can discuss about it. You know, there are both pros and cons in both approaches, but you know, we will discuss about it a little later.
So what is the scale of this data?
Scale of the data. So scale of the data. Basically, right now it's not much, but you know, we are aiming it to be able to support up to, like, you know, 3000 to 4000 TPS.
So right? Here we have used some partitioning logic to make sure that same order you are talking about.
Yeah,
so the same order.
Initially, you know, we started with a single partition Kafka topic, just to ensure that, you know, the ordering is guaranteed. But you know, we built the whole thing, then, you know, when we were doing a perf testing, you know, we were seeing that, you know, there were some performance issues with that. So then, you know, we have decided to go with multi-partition. Now, if you go with a multi-partition across the partition, you know, the ordering is not guaranteed, then how do you deal with it? So one of the thing what we did is, like, you know, so here, you know, you can have a hash partitioner, right? You know, use the hash partitioner with primary key as a key for it. Right. So basically, you know, what it does is for every record, you know, it pulls the primary key from the record, mm-hmm. right, and it does a hash partitioning to figure out, you know, to which partition, you know, it should send it to. So that way, you know, even though the ordering is not guaranteed across multiple partition, but within the partition, the ordering is guaranteed. But for single primary key, all the CDC events will go to the same partition. So that way, you know, we are solving that problem, right? You know, so this is one of the challenges that we faced, and then this is how, you know, we solved it.
Right, but primary key is incrementing, like, primary key has to be, is an integer, and it's...
it doesn't need to be an integer, you know, it can be string or anything, right? You know, anyway, we are doing an hash partition, right? So, it doesn't need to be any particular data type, anything is okay, right?
How much is the number of nodes of that Kafka cluster?
Here?
Yes.
So, we have a 3-node cluster, okay? So the next, what you have is like, you know, on the other
so,
side, you know,
sorry, one more thing. So you wanted ordering only for records of a given primary key.
Correct.
You did not want ordering across all the records.
What is the use?
No, I'm just asking.
Right?
I'm not sure about the use case, but across records you don't want.
Yeah, ordering. So I don't need it. You know,
okay.
So that's
for
a
given primary key you wanted. Okay.
Yeah.
That's how you ensured the partitioning.
Correct.
Okay.
Right. So on the other side, you know, we have got a Spark streaming application. Right. You know, in this case, you know, we are using Spark 1.6.1. You know, this project was started, you know, 1 year back. Right. So here what it does is, you know, it connects with a particular topic and, you know, it streams this data in a micro batch interval. And for each record, what it does is, you know, it does something called, you know, reconciliation. So basically what happens is, so whenever, you know, you are making any changes in the database, right? Let's assume that, you know, you are making an update change, right? So there are a few cases where when you are making an update, right, you know, you are getting only the updated columns as a CDC, not the complete record. So in that case, you know, what we were doing is, like, you know, we were maintaining the state in Cassandra. So in case, you know, if you get a partial record, we go and pull the remaining fields from Cassandra and, you know, construct the complete record so that the downstream processing doesn't need to worry whether it's dealing with the delta processing or, you know, the complete record process. So that is one thing. And other thing what it does is, you know, the main job is joining, right? So so
in a complete dump of your data in Cassandra for you to find out the other features.
Yeah, so we have the complete dump
of whatever is there in the SQL.
Yes, right. So the other one is like joining. That is a major and complicated piece here. So for example, you know, in this case, let's say, you know, you want to join these two tables, right? You know, company's table is available there and address table is available there, and there is a foreign key relationship. Like, company's table has a address ID field, and here, you know, you have address ID field, which is a primary key. So this is the address ID field, which is a foreign key. So these two needs to be joined, and, you know, we need to produce a denormalized event, right? So here I have taken only two table for joining, but, you know, in our case, you know, it's highly complicated. There are cases where we have to join with 12 different tables, right? And so we have solved that. So what it does is, you know, for each table, we have defined a join configuration. Join configuration is nothing but a primary key foreign key relationship, right? So it's basically, it will say that, you know, this is the table, and this is the primary key, and this is the foreign key, this is the foreign table, and this is the foreign key. Something like that, right? You know, so it has to, based on that information, it has to join and produce the final outcome. So now, since you have the complete state stored in Cassandra, this is something which is possible. You know, if you go with the streaming technologies, you know, whatever is providing in most cases, when we started, it was like, you know, only for a particular window of time. Like, you know, you can have it for 5 minutes, 30 minutes, or 1 hour, not for like an entire duration, right? That was not possible.
So what percentage of your transactions are really updates and
events? Sorry?
What percentage of the transactions are
really updates? Actually, this system was built in a mind that, you know, update, insert, delete, anything can happen anytime.
Because one problem I can see is Cassandra, if you deliver with multiple updates and deletes, you end up with a lot of time during compaction.
Yeah, so in fact, you know, if you see,
I think the other thing is that how do you even update Cassandra?
Correct. Now, let me come to the point. You know, I have put one more thing here called Datamic, right? So this is one thing, you know, which is helping us big time, right? In fact, you know, I did a very detailed session on, you know, what are the challenges and why we decided to pick Datamic in my previous talk, and it's available in YouTube. I will send it to the group. You can take a look at it, right? But you know, most of it is helped here. So I'll just to give you a brief idea about, you know, what Datamic is. So there is a guy called, you know, Rick, you know, he was an original database author, right? So what he did is, like, he took a step back and started looking at the RDBMS technology, right? So those RDBMS architecture, right, it was built for the hardware in which were available in the older system, right? Now the entire ecosystem has evolved big time, right? So that's the reason what he decided to do is, like, now I will partition this monolith RDBMS into small pieces, right? He identified, you know, four different pieces. One is a query engine, other one is the indexing component, and then storage, right? Storage, query engine, indexing, plus transaction handler, right? So those are the four components. So now what he decided to do is, like, you know, the transaction handler or the write operation handler with indexer. Now those two are combined, and, you know, he created one component for it. And storage is something, you know, which is a separate component, and query engine is another component. So now it's no more a monolithic. He divided that into three different pieces, and they are distributed across network, right? And now if you see, you know, he doesn't want to solve the problem of storage, because, you know, there are already a lot of technologies available. So he decided to pick, you know, whatever is existing, already existing. And it can work with Cassandra, React, DynamoDB, and any RDBMS, and bunch of other stuff also. So that's why, you know, you have this on top of this. And this provides an interesting schema called, you know, EVAT data model. It looks almost similar to columnar, and it has got, you know, a lot of interesting properties. I would encourage you guys to, you know, take a look at my previous talk, plus also read about data bank, right? And one of the other thing what it does is the query engine, right? It's no more as a server, you know, which is sitting somewhere else, and the client goes and talks to that. The query engine sits inside your application. It's tightly embedded into your application, right? So now the query engine being embedded into your application, and it also has a cache. So what it does is, so anything that you want to read or update, you know, it goes through that. So there are many cases, you know, you don't even need to reach out to the store. You know, you might get the data readily available within your application itself.
But won't it be something like a Spark SQL in a way, like, I mean, if you're writing that Spark application,
yeah,
and you're using Spark SQL, then that is also query engine which is sitting right inside your application.
Correct. So it is very much similar. But, you know, I would encourage you to, you know, look at that talk. You know, there are some of other things, you know, how do you deal with the schema evolution, and how do you deal with the out of order event handling, and all those things are, you know, handled very well over there. And, you know, I would encourage you to, you know, look at that talk. Right. So this is about that. So the state is maintained, and, you know, you go on query and you create a denormalized event, and you publish that denormalized event to the topic. So here across the board, you know, what we have chosen is Auro as a format. So that's what, you know, we are using it here. And then the next one is a streaming transformer.
This is the first Kafka topics, and the second Spark streaming, third is again Kafka topic. You are basically joining and stuff. You can achieve it through one Kafka topic with Kafka streams. Has that been tried out, evaluated?
Yeah, we can do that. The reason why we have splitted it is primarily because, you know, it gives a lot of flexibility. Like, in case, you know, if you don't want this kind of functionality, you know, you can directly, you know, use this, plug this in here. Plus, you know, even for the engineering productivity, right, you know, we can divide this into smaller pieces and, you know, have small micro teams working on that. Plus, if you want to deploy it, right, you know, you don't need to deploy the whole thing, you know, like, individual pieces can be deployed, and scalability, all those things, you know, you can focus on, you know, individual components. So the whole thing was, like, you know, framed in a model that Unix pipe kind of model, right? You know, you have one command, you know, which is running and producing the output. Output of a first command will go as an input to the second command, that kind of thing. So here, output of this is going to this one, and so on, like that, right? And moreover, you know, we wanted to have a clear segregation. Like, till here, you know, if you see, you know, whatever we are doing, you know, it's kind of replicating the source database as it is here, with some join, right? And then, you know, we are applying the transformation, right? So that's kind of one segregation that we would like to have, right? And so here, you know, if you see, you know, what this transformer does is, you know, it will pull the transformation for each entity and apply the transformation. So for so here, in our case, you know, we had to do only the single row transformation. It was not a case that, you know, we have to do any kind of aggregates. So what we did is, you know, we have picked a particular technology from Cloudera called Morphling, right? So that also gives you a label-based transformation. And this is also, you know, based on the Unix pipe kind of approach, right? You know, you can have, like, multiple commands, which are lined up in a particular order, and output of command 1 will go as an input to the command 2, and so on. Right? So it's defined in a JSON kind of format. You just pull that JSON and apply that and produce the output and send it to the this guy. So here, one of the reason why we wanted to externalize this join configuration and transformation suite is like primarily because, you know, today, you know, you might be dealing with one particular data source, and tomorrow you might want to deal with some other DB schema. So depending on the DB schema, and we should be able to change the configuration here and there, and the entire pipe should be able to work. So we built it as a data platform, so to enable that, right? And towards the end, you know, you have got Kafka Connect, which is basically it pulls the data from here and publishes it to the Salesforce, right? This is more of a JSON, and there we are using it as a JSON. Okay, so far it's clear. Okay, so here the technology is used. We are using Confluent 2.0.1, Kafka Schema Registry, Kafka Connect, Zookeeper, all of them are coming from there. Spark Streaming 1.6.1, Datomic 0.9, which is sitting on top of DSE 4.2, which is a Cassandra. Okay, so first, you know, we need to look at the CDC schema, right? You know, I was telling that, you know, that we are capturing the CDC and then, you know, processing that. So what are information, you know, should, of course, payload, right? So the payload contains two different information. One is before record and the other one is after record. What do I mean by before record and after record, right? Anytime, you know, you want to apply a DB transaction, right? When you commit a DB commit, right? So before commit, what was the state of that record? After commit, what was the state of that record? So that is what is captured through these two fields. So basically, you know, it's a Auro record, right? You know, if you are having like four different fields in your DB table, all those four different fields will come here as a before state, and the other four, same four fields will come as a after record, right? Is this good enough? So we need to have some more metadata information, which is very much needed for, you know, these kind of stream processing, right? So when you commit a transaction, right, what happens is, in any DB, you know, you will have something called, you know, transaction identifier, which uniquely identifies the transaction within that database, right? So that we call it as a fragment number, sequence number, right? So that is one identifier which is being used to uniquely identify any transaction. And within a transaction, you might be doing multiple operations, right? Each of those operations are uniquely identified through the fragment number, right? So with these two things, like sequence number and fragment number, you will be able to uniquely identify any CDC event and throughout your pipe, right? And this is kind of, you know, helping us for, you know, traceability and building some of the auditing frameworks and metrics monitoring and things like that. So we will see some of it a little later. So this is something, you know, which is very, very important to improve that. And apart from that, you know, we are also capturing the table name, right? So if you look at, you know, our architecture is like swim lane kind of architecture. For each table, you know, you have one lane, right? So having a table name over there helps, and, you know, so it helps us to, you know, do certain things, you know, very efficiently, plus generate the configuration in a dynamic fashion and things like that. Plus shard ID. So in many cases, you know, you will have a RDBMS data which is getting sharded, right? And ideally, you know, you would expect that in a table which is sitting in multiple shards to have a same schema. That's an ideal scenario, but, you know, there are a few cases where, you know, it's broken, right? So now what do you do? You know, in that case, you know, how do you deal with that? So for that reason, you know, we are capturing the shard ID also, right? So that, you know, when we are constructing the Auro schema, so we include shard ID plus table name as a one schema name, right? So basically, you know, for each table and shard, you will have one schema, Auro schema, right? And another thing is like primary key information. This is primarily for, you know, if you want to do update or delete, you know, how do you deal with that? So, and we also have source DB timestamp. So this will be useful for computing your SLA and things like that. So these are some of the metadata information, you know, which we are capturing, plus, you know, changed columns also. like in any transaction, you know, when you commit, you know, what are the columns which are changed. So this is also, you know, which is captured as a separate metadata field, so which we can use for, you know, better optimization. Yes. Right. So in streaming, you know, one of the things, you know, there are a bunch of challenges. You know, one of the challenges is like out of sequence, right? So let's say that update event for a single primary key came first, and then, you know, the next one was insert, right? Now how do you deal with that, right? So first of all, how will you be able to, first you need to detect it, right? You know, whether this was a out of sequence or not. So for that itself, you know, you need to figure out, you know, how do you detect it, right? So in this case, you know, how do you detect it? So as I said earlier, you know, these fragment number and sequence number, they are uniquely identifying. And one other thing what it does is, you know, it's monotonically, you know, increasing, right? So now, you know, can we rely on that to, you know, detect whether any out of sequence event happened or not, right? So in fact, you know, it's helping there as well, right? And second one is, you know, how do you handle it, right? So as I said earlier, you know, you can choose, you know, single partition Kafka topic, so that way, you know, the ordering is fully guaranteed. In case, you know, if you want to use multiple partition, you know, choose PK as a partitioning key, right, primary key. So that way, you know, you are safeguarded. Even though they are going into different partitions, for single primary key, you know, all the CDC even will go to the same partition, right? And when it comes to updating any remote store, like in Cassandra or whatever, right, what do you need to do in case, you know, out of sequence event happened? First, read the event, and then, you know, you try to reconcile and then update it, right? That's one way of doing it. Or the other way is go with the EVAT data model with change history. So this is where the data helps big time. So basically, what I will give you a little bit idea about what it is. So for example, you know, if you have a table called, let's say, addresses table, right? So usually in row oriented format, you know, you will have it like address ID, street, city, like this, right? But in EVAT model, you know, you don't store it like this. You know, it's somewhat similar to, you know, columnar format. So basically, so what you say is entity ID, let's say, you know, 101, and attribute name, right? So attribute name, I will say address ID, or let's say, you know, street, right? And value is HSR layout. And this happened at time T1, some transactor ID, and 1:1, CD, VLR, this also happened at time T1, street, Koramugla, at time T2, right? So this means that, you know, so these two are belonging to a single record, right? And this is an update happened. Right, you know, this is overwriting this particular attribute, right? But you maintain the entire change history, and depending on this value, you know, you choose which is the latest one, and so on. So now, when you have this kind of data model, like let's say an update came first, you know, you apply this here, right? Fine, no problem. You just pull the data from here and publish the denormalized event. Then the insert came; these two has come, right? You apply it again. You pull the latest event. Right? Now, when you pull the latest event, this will come, this will come, this will not come. Right? Now, you know, you pull the latest event and then you construct your denormalized event and publish it downstream. Right? So this way, you know, what we are saying is, you know, you will be eventually consistent. Getting it? Okay. So these are some of the ways to handle it. And in fact, you know, I have given a very detailed talk on this in my previous talk. I would encourage you to take a look at that. Later I will.
Does it happen in your case out of order events? I mean, because the way you are querying, it should not happen, right?
No, it should not happen, but there are few cases where it can happen, you know. Primarily because, you know, when you are publishing the event to Kafka, you are having a batch, right? And it might do some retry, and we have noticed it, you know, there are very, very rare cases, you know, it was occurring. It was not like, you know, very common case, but, you know, very rarely, you know, it occurs. Okay.
So how often do you see that data in Cassandra?
How often?
So you take the partial data you take and then from Cassandra you take the.
Yeah, so here in our case, you know, we sync it as and when the data comes.
So
twice,
so both will
happen. Yeah, so that, in fact, you know, the one of the reason why, which is helping us is like the query engine is sitting inside your application with the cache, right? You know, that the it optimizes the read. Plus, you know, you can index any column here, right? You know, there is no restriction, and that is also, you know, helping us big time, right? So can we allow delayed events? Right. It is expected that in a distributed application, and if you are expecting, if you are calling event across multiple network calls, delayed event will happen. You know, there is no question of whether you want to you know, accept it or not. Right. It will happen in a unit design your system according to that. Right. So now, how do you deal with that? So basically, as I said, you know, we have to embrace eventual consistency. Right. So for example, in our case, like we are trying to join between companies and addresses. Let's say, you know, the company's address, company's record has come at time T1 and address is coming like, you know, 30 minutes later. Right. These kind of things can happen, you know, even though that in the database, the transaction was committed almost at the same time, because, you know, it has to travel through the network, you know, anything can happen in between. Right. So these things are bound to happen. Right. You need to design a system to considering all these things, right? That's how, you know, that's why, you know, we are maintaining the state here. So in my architecture, if you see, right, for each table, you know, we have defined a join configuration. So whenever this guy comes, it will take a look at it here. If the other records are available, it will join and publish it, right? In case if other record is not available, fine. Even then, you know, it will go ahead and publish whatever it's available. So whenever this guy comes, right, this will again, you know, go ahead and join with the relevant record, and that will take care of, you know, publishing it to the downstream. So that way, you know, we are eventually consistent. Right? So one other thing is like, you know, eventually is okay, but never is not okay. Never means like, you know, there is a data loss, right, which is not in general acceptable. Right. In many streaming technologies, they provide a state like, you know, you can maintain it for 5 minutes, 30 minutes or and so on, but not for entirely. But recently, you know, there are some revolution is happening in that. So is that an option? Like, you know, if we maintain the state only for 5 minutes, is it good enough? It again, you know, depends on, you know, what kind of application that you are building. Like in case, you know, if you are building something like, you know, clickstream kind of data, you know, which is okay, where, you know, minimal data loss is considered acceptable for performance and scale, you know, you can go ahead with that. But here in our case, you know, since you are dealing with financial record, you know, this is not okay. So basically, you know, you need to make a decision based on that, right? And whether it's okay or not. Right? And another thing to take a look at it, right? You know, some of the people were, you know, very keen on this, right? So Spark streaming. In general, you know, whether you want to write a streaming application which is highly optimized for latency or throughput, right? Latency means like an end-to-end latency, you know, the moment the event occurs, you know, how soon it reaches the target, right? And throughput means like, you know, per second, you know, how many events, you know, you can process, right? They are kind of, you know, somewhat, you know, contradicting with each other. Yeah. So there are, in fact, there are a set of streaming technologies which are highly optimized for latency purposes, like, you know, Storm and things like that. But there are other guys, you know, who are optimized for, you know, throughput with micro batch kind of model, right? So in Spark streaming itself, you know, you have both construct, like for each, like, you know, you can take one event at a time and then, you know, process it and then publish it, and then, you know, take another event and then process it and then publish, right? So here one of the drawback with this approach is if you have to update the remote data store, like, you know, Cassandra or whatever, which is not inside your Spark application, right? You know, you have to update some remote data store, which is a network call, right? And for each record, you know, if you have to make a network call, it will be very expensive, right? Rather, you know, if you go with a MapReduce kind of approach, right? Meaning micro batch. Let's take 100 records at a time. I will do all the pre-processing, everything required, and I update all the 100 records to the remote data store. So that way, you know, I'm minimizing the number of network calls, which will help me to achieve the throughput in a very big way. And it may not penalize the latency also in a big time. Right? So this is some of the trade-off that you need to make. Right? You know, but you know, if latency is highly important for you, and if the load is also very, very minimal, you know, you can go ahead and use the for each. But otherwise, you know, probably I would encourage you to, you know, start looking at these approaches. Right? Okay. So we are dealing with RDBMS data. Right? And schema evolves over time. Right? Let's say, you know, you've got an address table with three fields. And tomorrow suddenly, you know, somebody adds another field called in a country. Right? Now how do you deal with that? Right? So that's the reason. So basically, you know, at time t1, this is the schema. At time t2, the schema has changed. Right? So does it mean that downstream processing has to fail? So how do you deal with that? Right? So that's why, you know, you have got this schema registry. Right? So this is the messages are getting produced for Kafka topic, and this is where, you know, you are consuming the messages. So this schema registry is coming from Confluent platform. So what it does is, you know, in Kafka, when you are producing the messages, you know, you can configure something called, you know, serializer. Right? So if you are publishing Auro record, the serializer will take that Auro record and serializes it to produce byte array. Right? And that byte array is the one which is getting stored in your Kafka topic. Okay? Now, if you just store the byte array, how will you recover the schema? Right? That is where the problem. So basically what it does is that serializer, for a given Auro record, first it identifies what is the right schema which is available in the schema registry, right? And each schema is associated with a particular schema ID, which is unique for each schema. And it attaches that schema ID with that byte array. So basically the first 4 byte is schema ID, and then the byte array of the Auro record comes, right? So that's how it gets stored. So at the other side, when you want to deserialize it, right? What you do is, you read the message, you get byte array, right? And now you read that first 4 byte, right? Which is an indicator for the schema ID, and use that schema ID to go and pull the Auro schema from here and deserialize the event, and you produce the Auro record from here.
This is done by your code or Confluent provides it?
This is provided by the Confluent.
Confluent, out of the box.
Okay. Yeah. So here, the important thing to note is, whether you use Confluent schema registry or some other schema registry or your own schema registry, right? So it should support versioning, right? For the same schema, you know, since it evolves over a period of time, it should be able to support versioning. Only then, you know, you will be able to evolve your schema automatically, right? Now, let's imagine a case that, you know, you have got message 1 and message 2, right? And both are, message 1 is with schema 1 and message 2 is with schema 2, right? So both can get serialized and deserialized comfortably without breaking anything, right? Okay, so that is one of the problems. So we'll talk about the next set of problems, right? So basically what I'm doing is, I'm taking particular challenges one at a time, and then, you know, I'm talking about what was the challenge, and then, you know, how did we solve that problem, right?
So how is that thing going end to end, in the sense that from the time when the source database column is added, at the same time you're also adding the column in Cassandra database?
Yes, you know, I didn't cover that part, but it's covered in my previous talk. So here, you know, if you go with this EVAT model, right, let's say that, you know, new column is getting added in your source database, right, country, right? So now you have got a new schema in your Auro, right? So here in your swap streaming, you can detect by looking at the schema of current one and the previous one, you know, what has changed, right? Now, that particular field alone, it can be installed here, because, you know, this is an EVAT model, right? So it's basically, you know, all you are saying is,
But then you are.
So here you will say that in 101, country and India.
So you're saying within Cassandra you will add it to the same column family, a new column will get added to
it? No, the thing is, like, you know, we are dealing with data making. It's completely abstracted, whether it's Cassandra or DynamoDB, all those things are completely abstracted.
Okay.
So for us, you know, the interface is datamic only. The datamic provides this support.
But the new column will, in the this other database, will get added automatically.
No, you think of it like this, right? You know, so suppose, you know, forget about datamic, right, for a moment.
Yeah.
Right now, if you want to use this kind of model,
yeah,
can you create a table with this model? Entity ID,
yes.
Attribute name, value, and then, you know, transactor timestamp. Right now, if you create a table like this, do you have to change the schema?
Oh, you're saying the schema is exactly this within Cassandra also.
Right? You don't have to change the schema. It's just that, you know, you are adding one extra row.
Yes.
Data.
But then this schema can be used while you are in motion or in transition.
Correct.
But not at rest. In the sense that this, this is like an event stream. This is not a current view of something. Right? So to get the current view from a database, it will become very difficult if you follow this kind of a schema.
Current
as
view?
So as a change list, it's a good schema to propagate through your pipelines, but you'll have to, at some point you'll have to aggregate the schema and then
read the data from here and then, you know.
Yeah, so now let's say when I have to read the data from something like Cassandra database, what I am interested in, again the same thing, that for 101, what are all the columns, right? Now for 101, what are the current value of all the columns? That is very difficult to gauge from this data. It's kind of, you have to see, go in the reverse direction and see.
But that's the reason, you know, we are using datamic. Right? You know, a lot of those complexities and some of the performance things are, you know, taken care nicely by that. Right? Otherwise, you know, we would have designed
our own table. Okay, so within Cassandra, this kind of schema will be there, but then datamic will give you that view of one specific.
Yeah, it will give you a view.
Interesting.
Right? Okay, so that's how the schema evolution is automatically taken care. So when you go live, right, you know, you have built a pipe and you have tested it, and one fine day you are saying that, you know, I am ready to go. Now remember that, you know, what we have built is a stateful stream first thing. And when you enable CDC, the CDC will get captured from that particular time onwards, right? But what happens to the historic data which is sitting over there, right? So that means, you know, you need to come up with some kind of a special handling for, you know, bootstrapping your system, right? So that is something, you know, you need to take care of it. So in our case, you know, what we have done is we have built a bootstrap connector, which is a little extension of that Kafka connector, CDC connector. And this guy bootstrap connector goes and directly fetches the source schema, right? And it loads the data, right? Not the CDC schema, but it goes and directly fetches the source schema and loads it into our system. And since it's a bootstrap, and it obviously will have a huge data, and that means, you know, it will take few minutes or hours, you know, depending on the load. During this bootstrap process, your database state is getting changed. You cannot stop that, right? Now, what does it mean? Does it mean, you know, data loss, or how do you deal with that, right? So one way to deal with that is enable CDC before you bootstrap. Right? You first enable the CDC, and you capture the data till Kafka. And then, you know, you go ahead and do the bootstrap, right? And once the system is bootstrapped, then, you know, from the CDC, you just start playing your, you start your pipe, right? So this means that, you know, you will have duplicates, right? Obviously, you know, you will have duplicate records. So, but the good part about is there is no data loss here, right? So to embrace zero data loss, you know, we have decided to compromise on that duplicate. But, you know, we have built a system which is kind of, you know, very idempotent, which takes care of dealing with duplicates. Right? So this means that, you know, basically, you know, we need to embrace at least one semantics. Right? And irrespective of all that, you know, how good, you know, you have coded and all that, in any data pipeline, it is bound to have some data loss or some kind of corruption is bound to happen. Right? So that is something, you know, you cannot completely eliminate. So you need to have some kind of a safety net for that. Like, how do you recover from that situation? So one other thing what we have done is, you know, selective bootstrap. In case, you know, if you identify that, you know, one of the record was lost or you know it got corrupted due to some defect or whatever, or misconfiguration or whatever kind of thing. So what we do is like we have an ability to go and replay only that particular record right from the source database. So this is one of the safety net, you know, you should always have it. Otherwise, you know, your life will become very difficult in the protection environment. Okay, so the other problem, right? You know, I have published, I have my pipe is running in production. For past n hours, you know, I have published the corrupted record. Why the corruption can happen? It could be because of some defect in my code or some misconfiguration or some system failure. You know, any of these can, or you know, all the three are happening. You never know. Right? So, how do you deal with this? Right? You can fix the problem. You can push it. But, will it fix the data retrospectively? What happened to the data which was corrupted for past n hour? Right? So now, you know, you need to have a mechanism to, you know, deal with those kind of things as well. So answer is build replay. Right. So when you are using Kafka as one of your streaming platforms or you know the ingestion buffer, right? You know Kafka deals with you know the offset kind of mechanism, right? So whenever you are processing that, you know you should store your offset somewhere, you know till which point you know your process did. And you know if you want to replay, you know, just change the offset to some older value, and then restart your application. You know, it should be able to correct it automatically, right? So in our case, you know, we have built a replay at every stage of the pipe. You know, you would have seen like 4 or 5 stages, and we have built it every stage. But I would recommend at least the very first stage, you know, you should have it.
So for how long you keep the data in Kafka?
Again, you know, it depends. You know, in our case, you know, it's 30 days. So now, how do you build replay, right? As I said, you know, you have to have a checkpoint, right? Per topic, partition, and what is the offset, right? So till which point you know you have processed it. So that information you need to capture it. And traceability, right? In case you know if you want to go back, right? So like you know, if you know that in the last 5 hours of data is corrupted, I want to go back to 5 hours a little earlier, then you know you need to know you know what is the offset, right? You know, basically there has to be some kind of correlation. Right, between time and offset or some kind of mechanism where you know you need to be able to trace it back to the previous offset and then you know start from it.
So in the code DAWA, because in the EAVT model what we were doing is we were comparing the timestamp, right? The latest timestamp we will pick and the previous one we will reject. So in the replay mode you have certain kind of a flag where you will see that even because now the data is corrupted but timestamp is updated. Right, so the timestamp is let's say of 8 o'clock and you're trying to replay from 5 o'clock. So when
yeah,
you get
so, so this is something you know you need to handle it. Yeah, I got your point, you know. So when you go back in time, you know, yes, you know, this is something you need to take care of.
Will flush the data before, like the erroneous data, so that this is taken care of? How do we handle it?
No, so in our case, you know, what we do is we have that, as I said, the fragment number and the sequence number combination is there, right? So we use that to you know, detect you know, whether this data that we have got is fresh data or you know, older data, and if it's older data, you know, how do you deal with that? All those logic is written.
That is part of your visible.
Right? So Spark also gives you checkpointing. Right? It's just that you know you need to specify you know, only one line of code. Like in your context when you're creating in Spark 1.6, you just have to say you know, checkpoint. Right, and it can automatically checkpoint to HDFS directory, and it is also used for you know failover for Spark driver as well. Now, can we rely on this checkpointing? We'll come to that. Right, what are the pitfalls of it? Spark checkpoints are you know it checkpoints the entire tag, which is a binary. Now, can you read the binary like you know till which offset you know, it was processed, and can you change the offset? Nothing can be done there, right? Which is not possible. And another problem is, will you be able to upgrade or reconfigure your Spark application without deleting your checkpoint directory? It's not possible because you know it stores the entire DAG. So that means including the configuration, including the code, right? The entire lineage, right? Everything is stored in the checkpoint directory, right? Now when you restart it without deleting the checkpoint directory, it will start reading from there. So whatever new configuration that you are giving or the new code or new library that you are giving, it will not take that. Okay. So if you look at the Spark documentation, they have given a very roundabout way of doing it. You know, all you need to do is first drain your Kafka topic completely, and then you start feeding your data into a new topic, and then you upgrade your Spark application to listen to that new topic, and then go from there. Which is an operational nightmare, in my opinion, right? But if you maintain your own checkpoint, do you have to worry about all those things? You can still listen to the same topic. You can stop the pipe anytime you want. You can delete the checkpoint directory. You don't even need to have the checkpoint directory. You will have your own checkpoint store, and you will read from there whatever the offset you have processed, and from there you can start continuing. And even if you want to change the offset to older value, you can go ahead and change it there and start from there, which makes your life easy in the protection system.
So I think that feature was added in Spark to give that exactly one semantics, right? So what you are doing is you are saying we are doing at least one semantics, and then in making sure that our system is idempotent so that it can take care of...
No, even irrespective of whether it's at least one semantics or exactly one semantics, I have a different problem here. I want to upgrade my Spark application, right? So without deleting my checkpoint directory, will I be able to do that? Spark right now doesn't support that. You can read it in the documentation. It's very well written. Even in the latest Spark, this is the case. So that's why I would strongly recommend don't rely on checkpointing of Spark for doing any of your replay or any of these things. That it will limit your capability to some extent. Right? These things are very, very important, right? Reconfigure, upgrade. We want to keep everybody stopping about agile and things like that, right? And also, one other thing I noticed is it does auto acknowledgement. When it consumes the messages from the Kafka topic, right? As soon as it consumed, it kind of auto acknowledged, meaning the moment it consumes the messages, the offset is stored in the checkpoint directory. Irrespective of whether you have completed the processing of that particular batch successfully or there was some failure. So we were doing a Hatchet testing of Cassandra and Redami, and even though the node went down and it was throwing multiple exceptions one after the other, but the offset kept increasing, right? So that was a major problem for us, right? What I want is once I successfully process it, only then it should be checkpointed. Right? It should not be before processing, you checkpoint it. That was one thing, which we noticed, and considering all these things, I decided to scrap Spark checkpointing, and we went with our own. In fact, we started with Spark checkpointing, and at one point, we decided that it's not helping us for replay and things like that. We decided to have our own checkpoint store along with the Spark checkpointing, hoping that Spark checkpointing will help for master failover. But considering after seeing that the auto acknowledgement problem, I decided to scrap that completely, and we are using our own store for Spark driver failover case as well.
Is this not configurable when do you want to acknowledge?
No.
So would you keep in your checkpointing thing only offsets which have been processed or more info?
So what we keep is topic, partition, offset, fragment number and sequence number.
Okay.
So those are the five information state. Okay, so this is another interesting problem. It didn't happen with our product, but our neighboring team had this problem. They were running in production with three node Kafka brokers, and all of a sudden all the node went down. Okay, so what do? You usually restart, right, one by one. Then after restarting, we notice the data loss at Kafka. Is it possible? Does Kafka lose data?
they were not replicated well, then.
Okay, let's look at it. Let's look at the replication a little bit deeper, right? You know, you have got Jokeeper cluster, which is primarily a metadata plus group management and leader election. All those things are represented by the Jokeeper, right? So we have got three brokers, right? And for each topic and partition combination, you will have three replicas, and one of it is selected as a leader, right? In this case, you know, this one is a leader. So leader is the one, you know, which is responsible for both read and write. That means, you know, producer will connect to it, consumer will also connect to it. Right? Others are just a replica, just for, you know, high availability purpose. Right? So from here, you know, it's getting replicated. Right? Now, let's assume the sequence of you know, how these broker went down. Node 1 went down. Right? That was a leader. Now, the node goes down, the leader election will happen. Right? And Kafka can support in n minus 1 node failure. Right? So this guy got elected as a new leader. And after 10 minutes, this guy also went down. Still, you know, you have got this guy. Right? So now this guy is doing both, you know, read and write. After another 15 minutes, this guy also went down. Okay? And then, you know, we restarted these nodes one by one. And now when we looked at the topic, from the log, you know, we could see that there were some record, you know, which we were consuming from the Kafka topic, but now all of a sudden it's vanished. How is it possible?
The order in which they went down.
Bring it up in the reverse order.
Yeah, so you should restart them in the reverse of order of failure. Right? So in the previous case, you know, if you look at first this went down, then this, right? If you have started these brokers in a reverse order, this and then this and then this, because this is the one in which has the latest synapse are, then the moment you started, this will become a leader. So the other guy will become followers. So they will be able to catch up with this. But if you change the order, let's say, you know, you started this guy first, right? This died at time t1. So that means, you know, it has lost some records. Now if you start this, what will happen? There will be redux. So this is something, you know, which is a very, very important point you need to keep in mind.
But how did it happen?
How it happened was, like, there was one bug. So they were using it for batch processing, right? You know, ingestion was streaming, but, you know, consuming from Kafka topic was batching using KMOS. Okay? So for every 30 minutes, you know, it was able, it was trying to connect to it and get the data and do something. So the number of file descriptors were kept very low, which was like default. Okay, so for each socket connection, you know, it will open the, it will use one file descriptor, right? So because of this, plus in addition to that, you know, the Kafka itself had one defect on that particular thing, the socket cleanup. So considering these two cases, what happened was, like, when you use the system for about like 7-8 days, after that, you know, you experience this behavior, like all the nodes are going down one by one. So we bumped up the file descriptor to 64K. So that was helping us to some extent, but again, you know, because of that leak, you know, it was not fully helping, but this was one of the problems that we noticed.
How do you manage the producers in the meanwhile when this Kafka is down? So producers, basically the change data capture, the client which will be pushing data to Kafka, because all the Kafka is down,
they will retry a few times, right? You know, you can configure the retry in the producer configuration, and all the retry will fail.
But that part also you are checkpointing that, okay, from this point to this point, this has been sent to the producer.
Right. So that's what I said, right? You know, in our case, you know, we are checkpointing at every stage.
Okay.
For enabling the replicability to handle all these kind of cases.
Okay.
Okay.
One more thing. How do you track, okay, which system got, you know, which node, you know, got down first? That also has to be tracked, right?
No, it will be available in the log, right?
Okay. Again, it's not necessary that, for example, I'm saying in this particular case, all the data nodes might be gone. Okay. Assume that I'm creating one more case where you have 50 nodes. And one of the three nodes, whatever the replica is, all the data is in three nodes. Okay, same data is replicated in three nodes. Only those nodes have gone down. What will happen?
Only the replication gone down, but
yes.
Leader is active.
Leader is gone. Assume that out of 50 nodes, 1, 2, 3 node has this data. Leader was 1, it had gone down. After that, 2, and after that, 3. Okay. When we will come to know, okay, this instant means again data loss of whatever, same case I am.
One second, you know, is Sasank is here? I have given my lab mobile to you. Oh, sorry, I thought it is. Yeah.
I'm coming to the same issue of data loss. When we will come to that? Because in this particular case, okay, all the data node went down.
It's not data node, it's a broker node. Okay.
Sorry, okay.
Can you simplify the scenario? Can you tell me?
See, assume that there are 10 broker nodes.
Okay.
Okay, out of that, 3 broker nodes had all these replicas, everything, same. Same scenario happened. Now, how you will come to know?
Now, same scenario happened means all 10 broker will
not
down?
Not all 10. Three.
Only 3. Okay.
Three. But 3 has a replica of all those.
Okay, so the one set of data is replicated to these 3 broker and all these 3 went down. Okay.
Yes. Then, how you will come to know? Okay. This incident has happened. And because normally what happens is, moment the other data node is, node is ready, we will bring it up, right? Now, because only this incident happened for these nodes, I don't know which.
No, in general, you know, in fact, in our case also, what we are having is like for every node, you know, we have a health check, right? The moment it goes down, you know, we will get an alert within 2 minutes.
Yes.
Right? You know, then, you know, you can go and look at
it. In this particular case also, I got an alert, okay? I'm doing the maintenance for this.
See, in your case, you know, what you are saying is I have got a 10 broker Kafka cluster,
yes,
and three broker went down,
yes,
and then, you know, I was using those topics, right, and one of them got down when one by one. See, now that is not a big problem at all, right, you know, because, you know, you still have the other 7 brokers which are still running. It will do a rebalance and, you know, it will pick some other broker. So if one node goes down, right, you know, it can use.
All these 3 are related data, they are replicated in those 3 nodes only.
Correct.
Okay. Now, what happens, even though other processing, everything is running, now the first node, broker node is ready. Okay. I am assuming since my broker node is ready, I can bring it up, right? If I bring it up, data loss is going to happen. Because the last node, third node, where I process the rest of the data, right?
Time.
If one
node is gone down,
it goes to
the
second node.
Okay, so I have one other scenario. In the same thing, you know, we will talk about it. You know, then, you know, probably I think it will help. So, is it good enough? Right? Just restarting them in the reverse order of failure, is that itself is good enough? Right? No. So, what if the followers are lagging behind? Right? So, the earlier scenario, you know, we consider that all 3 replicas are in sync. Right, you know, any changes that you publish, you know, they all are in getting it updated in a timely manner. So even if one goes down, you know, it's not a big deal. But let's assume the case that, you know, the follower 2 and follower 3, they are lagging behind, right? Because, you know, it's a network thing, you know, anything can happen. And in fact, you know, one of the scenarios that, you know, even Confluent, they themselves acknowledged it, it was happening there. So the Kafka supports something called rolling upgrade, right? If you want to upgrade, you know, you don't need to bring down the entire cluster. You know, you can upgrade one node at a time and then, you know, put it back to the cluster and then take another node and then upgrade it, put it back, right? So that kind of rolling upgrade, you know, one of their clients was doing it. But unfortunately, what he was doing is he upgraded one node. The remaining 2 nodes, he forgot to upgrade. And after a day, he noticed that, you know, there was a big lag in the followers which is catching up, primarily because whatever the node which was upgraded, right, that had some serious performance fixes, and because of that node is performing extremely well, and the other nodes which didn't get upgraded, now they were lagging behind, right? And this took a very lot of time for them to figure out what exactly happened. And finally, when they upgraded, everything was all right. So these kind of things can happen. So one important thing to remember is, like, when you are setting up this kind of cluster, you should have a similar same configuration, including machine and the Kafka property files, the configuration files, and the which version of Kafka that you use, and the file descriptor configuration. All those things, you know, you should have it very much same. Only then, you know, the system will run smoothly. If you have, like, you know, low configure one and the other one is high configure, these kind of, you know, issues, you know, you will face very often, right? So one other thing, you know, how do you deal with that in case, you know, if one of the follower, irrespective of all these, can you ensure that, you know, the follower cannot lagging behind? It's not possible, right? You know, you can minimize such chances, but, you know, you cannot completely get rid of that problem. So this can still happen. So, right? So how the Kafka is dealing with that is, there is a concept called a min in sync replica. So whenever you are producing messages to Kafka, right, you can specify, you know, what should be the number of replicas which should have been received my update before I get my acknowledgement, right? So you can, if you want to be strongly consistent, you can say that, you know, I want all my three replicas to get updated, only then, you know, send me the acknowledgement. Or you can say that, you know, minimum of two is updated, you know, I'm fine, you know, you just send me the acknowledgement. But if the moment you say one, that means, you know, there is bound to, the data loss is bound to happen. But if you have this setting, right, correctly configured, you will not have any data loss at all. Now, let me ask you a question.
In that case, case monitoring, we don't need to worry about this case to start reverse or.
No, you still need to worry about it, because
if you lose more than these many nodes.
So it's a combination of, you have to still consider this along with that. So that is very important. What is your question?
My question was, when we have more than one of those replica numbers, and those broker nodes, say for example, 1, 2, 3, say, 1 failed, okay? And after some time, broker 2 also failed. Now, because probably this.
This will solve, but definitely there will be some latency introduced, because, you know, if you are bringing up new node, yeah, and that new node has to catch up with the leader, right? You know, it depends on, you know, how big the topic is, right? You know, that needs to be, you know, caught up, right? Based on that, you know, the acknowledgement might be delayed, right? You know, so you will have those
kind of. Which node is one acknowledgement that will be somewhere it will know, because node 1 is done.
No, there are admin operation, admin commands are available, and using which, you know, you can find out for which topic or and partition, you know, what are the brokers are, you know, in sync. So those you can be able to find it.
This will always be in order for a given partition. I mean, in the sense that if you have total of three replicas for that specific partition, and you say that this has to be need to go to only two. Then it will be only
not only two. It's saying minimum.
Yeah, minimum two. Minimum so when two. You are saying minimum two, then let's say they are node 1, 2, 3. Then the second will always be node 2. It will not be that for some writes after node 1 it will go to node 3, and for some it will go to node 2. Right?
No, basically, you know, what they are doing is, you know, if you look at this, right, you know, there is, in parallel, you know, it is getting copied. When you write, you know, here and here, you know, it's in parallel, it's getting copied, right?
So it can be anyone.
Yeah.
I mean, any of the.
So any two, you know.
Whichever responds first, it will go there.
Yeah, I'm good. So basically, you know, here what we are trying to ensure is, like, if you have copy only one replica, which is always a risk, right? Now, if you have the copy in one more place, which is kind of in the backup, then I'm good. So that's what, you know, we are trying to ensure here. And again, you know, if you want to have a strong consistency, you can go for three, but.
I'm just thinking of a case when there's some order breaks. Basically, like, packet one came. It got
no, the order will not break, right? See, the thing is, these followers, they are also internally using Kafka consumer only to replicate from here. So they will read in the same offset order. So the that will never happen.
So I think the main thing is that leader will always have all the...
Correct.
No. So I'm just thinking of a scenario. I'm not sure if it's possible. Packet 1 came to leader. It got replicated to node 2. Packet 2 came to leader again. It got replicated to node 3.
It can happen.
right? And then no, leader went down.
No, that thing, that, that what you are saying is, packet 3 will get replicated to node 3 only before, if packet 2 got already
okay.
replicated.
Okay.
Otherwise,
so on every node, it will be like in the same order.
So I have told you, right? This is also consumer.
Okay.
And this is also, you know, reading from this, the 0th offset, you know, one by one.
Right.
It cannot jump.
Right. Okay.
That is not possible.
Okay.
No, I think that happens because it's only about the minimum number of acknowledgement. So whenever a packet comes to the leader, it will go to all the followers.
No, but no. But the order will remain for
order remains same. Right? You
so it
see,
will not go
see,
to,
see, to the follower
to
right? This is not pushing. You are pulling from there.
No, but basically, so producer comes, it gets to the leader, right? And at that time, leader has to copy to all the followers. I mean, whatever mechanism.
No,
leader is not coming. The follower
push, pull or push doesn't matter. So let's abstract out that technical detail right now.
No, matters. It matters.
Okay, so basically, it goes to all of them.
Can we take it offline?
Ah, okay.
So, yeah.
Then complete your session. Then we
okay. Okay, so now the Kafka Connect setup, right? You know, so Kafka Connect, you know, supports two modes. One is a standalone mode, the other one is a distributed mode. Standalone mode means that, you know, it's just one application which you are running and which goes and pulls the data from source and, you know, publishes it to Kafka in case if it's an ingestion. If you are using it as an ingestion, it will pull the data from Kafka and publishes it to some store. So you will not have high availability there. But it's still useful for few cases, like, you know, if you want to use it as a logstash kind of agent or, you know, Splunk kind of agent, that kind of thing, you know, this standalone mode is very useful. But in our case, you know, we are reading the data from database, and it's not like you know, some agent is sitting over there. So we wanted a high availability. So that's why, you know, we are setting up a separate Kafka Connect cluster, which is a 3-node cluster. And which that's where, you know, the connectors are deployed and they will go and put the data from there. In case if one Kafka Connect worker goes down, then, you know, the load on that worker will get balanced to the remaining workers, right? So this is kind of, you know, helping us to enable the high availability for both ingestion and egestion. Okay, diagnosing data issues, right? You will have different kind of data issues, data loss, data corruption, SLMS, right? I expected this data within a minute, but, you know, it's not there. Now, how do you quickly diagnose these kind of issues, right? Especially in any data platform, even in a streaming platform, right? You know, this is kind of, you know, big problem because, you know, if you look at the streaming application which is running for, like, you know, few days or weeks or, you know, months, now the log file is so huge, right? How do you go and look at this? So basically, you know, one thing you need to keep in mind is you need a mechanism to, you know, track each event uniquely, the end-to-end pipe. So in our case, you know, what we are using is that fragment number, sequence number, the transaction semantic, which we are using it, and that is getting propagated throughout the pipe. So using that, you know, we will be able to track any event in the whole pipe, what happened, right? So what we are using is in the log4j, there is a concept of MDC. So any message that you log, right, you know, it will get stamped with a bunch of metadata fields, like whatever, you know, we discussed over there, that the fragment number, sequence number, table information, primary key, all those metadata fields are, you know, stamped there. And so you will be able to, you know, index on these fields and, you know, query the log, right? So you basically, you know, you need to use some kind of log aggregation. It can be Splunk or ELK, you know, whichever, you know, you want to use. In our case, you know, we chose Splunk because, you know, we already are there, bought the license. So basically, this is one of the very important thing to use it, because this will help you to diagnose the issues quickly and, you know, fix them. So another thing, batch versus stream, right? Is batch dead completely, or when do you use stream? So the primarily, you know, it is based on couple of things, right? You know, how time critical your data is, right? So in our case, you know, if you look at the data that we are streaming and publishing it to Salesforce, is for care agents and sales agents to use that and, you know, service the customer care calls, right? So most cases, you know, if any customer is using the application and if he's stuck with something, he's going to immediately call the customer care, right? So that means, you know, this is a time critical data. If the data is not available with the agent, and you know, if the agent is asking the customer, like, you know, what do you did, and what, then, you know, it's like you will end up spending a lot of time for handling that call, and, you know, which is not a good experience, right? You know, so this is a time critical data. So similar to that, you know, you need to decide, you know, whether you are dealing with time critical data or not. That is one important thing to consider. And another thing is how quickly, you know, you want to make decisions. For example, you know, fraud detection, right? So some financial transaction is happening, and, you know, you want to see, you know, whether it's fraud or not. You want to quickly detect it and, you know, make a decision based on that, and, you know, do some action. So these are some of the thing, you know, you need to consider. Otherwise, you know, in most cases, I would say 30 minutes or 10 minutes batch is good enough. Don't do over engineering. Streaming is a big, big complex piece. I have experienced it, and, you know, I want to tell you that. I mean, you need to be very, very careful with that. So there are a few cases where, you know, you want to do both batch and real-time streaming, because, you know, you are getting the data from one ingestion pipe, and you know, there are portion of data you might want to use it for streaming, and all the data you might want to use it for batch. Then, you know, how do you deal with that? You know, what kind of architectural pattern, you know, you would like to go for? So this is something, you know, we are following here. In our case, we have a database. All the data is getting ingested through either the Kafka Connect based CDC connector or a Golden Gate based adapter to Kafka, right? And each table goes to a different topic, right? And from here, you know, we have written one batch sync, which is directly taking the data into Hadoop, HDFS, or in case if you are in AWS, you can put it into S3. And from here itself, you know, you can do the streaming, right? If you start streaming from here, then, you know, the real-time SLA will be broken, right? You know, it will be a big problem there. So that's the reason, you know, you need to directly do it from here. And in general, you know, you might want to have two different type for, you know, stateful and stateless. There are certain things which you can optimize for stateless, which you may not be able to do it for stateful thing. So probably you might want to have two different pipe. So this is one of the pattern that we are following. So metrics and monitoring. So this is towards the end of it, like, right? So as I said earlier, you know, we have to guarantee zero data loss plus SLA is 1 minute. So now how do you even know that, you know, whether there was any data loss or whether there was any SLA miss and things like that, right? So here, you know, we have got five different stages, right? And each stage, you know, we are publishing something called, you know, audit event to another Kafka topic, which is called an audit topic, right? So basically, you know, what we are saying is, like, if I have processed some event, I will say that I have processed this event. Now, how do you say that, you know, I have processed this particular event? You remember, you know, the CDC, you get a header, which is a metadata field, like the fragment number, sequence number, table name, primary key, all those header, right? That entire header information is published to Kafka topic along with stage timestamp. Like, basically, at this particular time, I have seen this event. So basically, that information is getting published there, right? So now if one event is flowing through this pipe, you know, till here, you know, you will see that audit event, right? And so here, you know, we have got another small streaming job which reads it from here and publishes it to Splunk. You can use ELK if you want. In our case, as I said earlier, we already have bought a license, so that's why we are using Splunk. So in Splunk, you know, we have done a couple of dashboards for both data loss and SLA computation. So now if you want to do SLA computation, as I said earlier, the header in itself has the source DB timestamp, right? Another one is we are publishing a stage timestamp, right? So we can compute stage timestamp minus source DB timestamp. That will give me the SLA. In fact, you know, we are computing the SLA for each stage, so that will kind of help us to, you know, quickly identify, you know, which one is, you know, having a trouble, right? So otherwise, you know, we need to look at the log and do that. So that's why, you know, we are having a stage timestamp for each stage also. You know, we have SLA, and for the entire end-to-end pipe also, you know, we have an SLA. So here one other problem, what if the system clocks goes out of sync, right? So use NTP, put all the system switches in your pipe, everything has to be synced using NTP so that, you know, you compute the right time. So, are these the only challenge? In fact, you know, I missed data loss. I didn't cover that. You know, it's a very complex piece. You know, how do you compute data loss and things like that for the benefit of time. These are the only challenges? Definitely no. In fact, you know, there are a hell lot of challenges. You know, if we have to talk about all of them, you know, I might need another 4-5 hours. So, to discuss about all those things. So, for the benefit of time, I decided to pick only these and cover only those.
For the audit log, so you publish, assume that you have 10 stages. You publish an audit log at each stage. Why don't you just read, hook onto the same, because your connector between the stages is again a Kafka topic.
Correct.
Right? So, why don't you just listen to that Kafka topic and do the audit? Why do you have to publish an event back?
So, the thing is, so let me understand your question here. So what you are saying is?
So the connection between your CDC connector and reconcile, the way that you communicate between them, is it a Kafka?
So in the original,
yeah, it is through Kafka.
So why don't you just read the Kafka topic, because whatever message comes in there already has your data information. Why do you need to send an audit event back?
Yeah, so we are using that header only. We are using that header and publishing it that. Outside. So the primarily the thing is, like, you know, we wanted to keep all the metrics and monitoring infrastructure separately. Right? You know, this is one pipe I have. If I do anything here, this becomes, you know, very much custom for this particular pipe.
No, but I
won't be able to reuse this infrastructure.
I think the question is that in your original architecture, there was a Kafka layer every time you were processing something, right? So from those Kafka, if you can directly listen from those topics. Then you already get the audit events.
Extra audit events
instead of these
exactly
guys. But
you know, the thing is, like, you know, the audit number of audit event is not a question at all in our case. So the overall thing what we wanted to do is, like, you know, for any pipe, today it's this pipe, but you know, tomorrow if you want to replace it with another pipe or with the 2-stage, 5-stage, 10-stage, it doesn't really matter, right? We should be able to, you know, use this infrastructure as it is. Right, and that is one thing. And another thing is, like, today we are publishing it to Splunk, but in this side is also, you know, keep evolving. You know, Ops says that, you know, I want to get the data into Neuralink or, you know, some other new system, AppDynamic, blah 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 blah. So even though, you know, you want to change any of these, you know, I don't have to change anything here, right? And if you put all this logic here, then, you know, I lose that flexibility.
Not to put any extra logic there.
So what do you want to do here?
If you have the original,
what you are saying is, like, you know, just read the source DB timestamp and this one, and then
if you have the original architecture, I mean, will you be able to go back to the original architecture? So I think what he's trying to say is that you have already Kafkas everywhere, so just read directly from those Kafkas.
You need to generate a new audit event.
But that might be difficult if you don't have Kafka at any stage. I mean, that is probably
why I don't need to generate that part. I don't get it.
Every message that is flowing through your system.
Okay.
Each of the two systems are communicating via Kafka topic. Right?
I think that will become a dependency, I guess. That's why he's not doing that.
In that case, you need to infer.
Then,
each of those topics and infer whether the message has been.
So, audit can directly go from these Kafkas.
No, the thing is, like, you know, I want to publish the event, you know, once it has been successfully published to the outside.
Yes.
Successfully, right? So after processing it, then I emit the audit.
Yes, so you listen to that
not
topic.
To here.
Yes, I understand your problem. So when you publish it to the second one, after that you're publishing an audit event back.
Correct.
So my solution was to, why don't you, whatever message that you publish that already has that data information. So whatever streams that you are reading from one Kafka topic, now you're reading from one Kafka audit topic. For all the audit messages, you can hook up to, let's say, 2 to 3 topics together, whatever is there in your pipeline, and then aggregate it on your primary key and other information. You can avoid sending those audit logs from each and every stage.
No, actually, you know, what I said is SLA computation is only one part of it. Right? You know, we wanted to do, you know, audit logs and, in fact, you know, availability metrics kind of thing. For example, you know, we are publishing some event to Cassandra, and, you know, that has failed. And in that case also, you know, we will send an audit event, right?
I think within a stage also.
So basically, you know,
it's
not very limited to that. You know, so the entire alert system, metrics monitoring, everything is based on that.
I think the
not just audit.
No, not only SLA.
Right. I think the other thing is also he's only sending header, like this will have the whole message,
no.
Header plus the rest of the thing.
The scale with which it can expand to, if you start processing millions of transactions, may not be in your case, but if you start processing millions of transactions per second, those audit logs itself will be a big chunk for you to handle.
Yes, but that is the problem, right? That if
because
Kafka itself has the full message, right? In a sense, he's only sending the headers to the audit trails.
Even though you have a huge number of audit team, there in the audit pipe, the ordering guarantee is not required at all.
No, I'm not talking about the guarantee and all.
Let me come to that. Even if you have millions or billions, right? You can have multiple executors of Spark consuming from different partition, all of them publishing into Splunk or ELK.
So the whole infrastructure in terms of the Kafka messaging and everything will go up drastically. We had a similar case. Our case was not with respect to monitoring and everything. We just wanted to ensure that whether the message from source has reached the destination.
Right? Okay.
After that, we really don't care about the audit logs.
Okay.
So we also tried this approach, and because of the
here in this case, this is worrying.
Now you additionally clarified those points. So I was explaining my case, right?
Okay.
So where the auditing was the only concern.
Okay.
We had to audit whether message from source reached the destination or not.
Okay.
So in that case, the way that we went about is initially taking this route, but the whole platform infrastructure bloated up because number of events that we processed, because it was a store IoT data, right? So the sampling rate was very, very high, 100 messages per second from every sensor. So sending those audit logs was really bloating up the infrastructure. So this was another kind of solution for that. Just an addition for your information point. So
okay. Fine. Any other questions?
So, in general, this is a very big system that you have designed, with a lot of features and all. So, what was the development life cycle? I mean, you put something in production, then you kept on building additional replay functionality or monitoring functionality.
No,
you built everything and then put it to production.
Yeah, so because some of those things, replay, the data is broken, and if I don't have that capability, how will I address to customer, right? Problematic. In fact, some of those things, we have already envisioned and in the beginning itself, and we started building for it. And yeah, that's one of the reasons why it took a little longer time. Because you these things, you cannot put it in incrementally. Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much. Thanks for your time.